This morning's call to worship is from the work of the Reverend Teresa Ninan Soto. She calls this spilling the light. Some people are used to keeping rules. Don't cross the street when the light is red, only sensible. It turns out that keeping rules isn't the same as keeping covenant, which asks us, instead of keeping a bright line, to keep our promises. To what have we promised ourselves? To this moment in time and place, to this community, and even, tenderly interconnected, this planet. We promise ourselves to the idea that we are each and all human beings. We promise that there is something moving between us that we cannot tame and cannot measure. The chalice is a reminder that what flame we keep inside us cannot light the way. The light must spill to shine. The thing you must be is yourself, unadulterated, shedding the willingness to journey alone as though you are made of something hard and unforgivable. You are human. You belong right here, right now. And together we will chase away the sickness, the secrets, and leave only the open possibility that the future is a space for growth. Let us light our chalice. Sophie, thanks. It's going to help. It's going to light it. And the rest of you have a job, which is to say the words with us. We kindle this flame.
Welcome to all of you in this sanctuary and online who have chosen to be with us on this May 21st service at the First Unitarian Universalist Society of Burlington. Building is our theme today, and you can't help but be energized by those beautiful photographs of all of the youth preceding our service. I want to give thanks to David Ruffin, and to the youth advisors, and especially our youth, for putting together this special service after thoughtful exploration. My name is Betsy Ferries, and I'm a member of the Worship Associate Committee. Let us begin by recognizing and keeping in our thoughts this beautiful sanctuary and building that sits on the unceded land of the Western Abnaki and Missisquoi people. Whether you are regular attendees those of you returning to the sanctuary after an absence, or our regulars, we welcome you. Those of you who are watching on Livestream, we welcome you too. If you are first time or second time attending our service, would you be willing to raise your hand so we can acknowledge you? All right, thank you. We have our wonderful four welcome ambassadors today. And as I read your name, perhaps you could stand so we can acknowledge their service. We've got Carolyn and Richard Smiles, Betsy Thayer, and Mary Harrington. And these folks will be coffee hour after the service, right out here in front of the church, should you want to ask them questions or get some friendly greetings. You have one other you can fill out questions, or there's a card in the pew in front of you that if you want to fill that out, You can put it in the offertory basket or give it to one of our welcome ambassadors. And now let me welcome Peter Clavel.
So for full disclosure, I am the spouse of today's worship associate. But I want to say that's not why I'm behind this mic. I'm behind this mic because I am one of nine members of your board of trustees. And for months now, we've been working on the preparation of a budget for the year, which begins July 1. We've had the very able assistance of our Director of Operations and Finance, Christina Fulton, as well as the finance team, and we've put together a balanced budget for your consideration. You will be acting on this budget at our annual meeting on June 12th. Today, you'll have the opportunity to learn more about the budget. In the monthly conversation with board members, the focus will be on the budget, but also on anything else you might want to discuss. So I urge you to attend that conversation. It begins at 11:30 after the service in the parlors behind me. Also, be looking for a very important piece of information that will be arriving in your mailbox that will share with you at a very personal, intimate level how you can help us balance that budget. So thank you and look forward to ongoing discussions with you. 11:30 today.
Next Sunday, May 28th, there will be a recorded service available on YouTube and through the website. There will not be an in-person service because getting to the meeting house on Marathon Day / Memorial Day is very difficult. We hope you can watch the 10 a.m. service whenever it's convenient for you. The Sunday morning breakfast will happen as usual at 8 a.m. this week only if you're bringing some food supplies. They can be dropped off at the meeting house on either Saturday or Sunday morning. Saturday, it's between 9:30 and 10:30 you could drop off those items. And now I'll turn it over to David.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi. Good morning. I'm David Ruffin, in case I don't know you. You're Director of Youth and Creative Arts Ministries. And it's my deep pleasure and honor to welcome you all to Bridging Sunday. As I understand it, this ritual of honoring graduating seniors has had such an impact that a small school up the street decided that they also wanted to do their commencement on this weekend, just to keep up with this wonderful celebration happening down the hill. So we're in the theme, in the world of commencement together today. Really special that we have not only three youth who've been really active with youth in the last couple years and before during my time right up until this moment, but also youth who were active, really active in the community in their younger years and into middle school and into the beginning of youth. But then with the pandemic and also all of the many varied pathways of invitation there are in these high school years have not been as involved, but have come back to mark this moment and to be celebrated and seen by this community. So really grateful that we have seven in-person youth, and we'll also be honoring some youth who aren't with us in person this morning. And I just want to say that it's really important that we're doing this together because we aren't just celebrating these individuals. We're celebrating the fact that in the life of Bridging and life that's filled with transitions, like this big one for these young people, we don't do it alone. We do it together. So that's our role here this morning, to remember that and to remind these youth especially of that. And in that spirit, we're going to sing There's a River Flowing in My Soul, our first hymn, with words by Rose Sanders. And a few years back, when I was leading the Sanctuary Boston, a community for young adults in Boston, I wrote a few different lyrics to really emphasize that we do this together and the power in that. So if you know this one well, don't close your eyes the whole time, because the lyrics are a little bit different. We sing, there's a river flowing in my soul all the way through. We change the third little line of the chorus. You'll see. So let's sing it. Rise in body or in spirit or both.
There's a river flowing in my soul. There's a river flowing in my soul, and it's telling me that I'm somebody. There's a river flowing in my soul. There's a river flowing in my soul. There's a river. What I feel in me, there's a river flowing in my soul. There's a river flowing in my soul. There's a river flowing in my soul, in my soul, and I feel its power in our harmony.
Let's do that one again and cut out so we can hear those harmonies.
There's a river flowing in my soul. There's a river flowing in my soul.
And I feel its power.
And I feel its power in our harmony.
Where our rivers meet.
Where our rivers meet, there's a mighty sea. There's a river flowing in my soul.
Where our rivers, one more time. Thanks, everyone. So I'm going to invite first parents to come up and celebrate these youth that happen to be their very own children at this moment. We're also going to hear from a couple of the youth with some poetry and some music. And then we'll move toward celebrating this moment of marking this ritual. So I want to invite Susie McCoy to come up first, share a little bit about your experience as a family in faith development, and then go on to celebrate our first youth, your son.
Okay, can you hear me? All right, well, hey, good morning. Nice to be here. Nice to see so many cheery faces. So I'm Susie McCoy, and I am the mom of Jeffrey McCoy DeBros, AKA Gio. And I discovered the UU Church when I was looking for a church for Gio and I to attend post-Catholicism. I was hooked after Gary Kowalski's. I happened to come in when he was preaching Bowling with Jesus. I don't know if anybody remembers that one, his sermon. And then also I was kind of looking around at all the different, you know, possible congregations in Burlington, but the UU Religious Education Prospectus was really enticing. I love the fact that they celebrate and look at all the world's religions and traditions and celebrations. And Gia was christened here by Roddy O'Neill Cleary, and Bill was on the piano. And I can still see tall Gary with his long arms holding my infant son up so high, you know, so the congregation could welcome him and into our faith community. But I was like, you know, it took me 6 years to have that kid, like, be careful. When it came time to move from the nursery to the preschool room, we needed parents, as we still do, to lead the religious education classes. And I have taught middle school, and I have taught high school, and I have taught undergrad, and I have taught graduate school, but the idea of those little people terrified me. I was like, man, you could do damage to little kids, can't you? Like, I don't know if I can teach that. And Becca Grimm, I don't know if she's here, but she convinced me that I would suffice and survive as a preschool teacher, as her co-teacher. And so I began my time downstairs in the classrooms, learning and celebrating, as I said, the worldwide religious traditions and cultures alongside our blossoming kids. And we did, we had a blast. I have so many great memories of raising Gio here at FU USB. You saw a lot of the pictures up here that kind of just brought it all back. You know, the annual UU camping trip, the sixth grade trip to Boston, where we met Henry Thoreau, New York City Climate March, I think you saw, the UU Service Auction sledding parties. I don't know if the sledding parties made it. General Assembly, we attended with our kids in Providence, Rhode Island, Ferry Beach in Maine, the youth group New York City trip to food shelves and soup kitchens. There's no pictures of Jeff Trombauer in the fifth grade Bible study class, but I want you to think about, you know, I can remember vividly, you know, his calm demeanor. I don't know, is Jeff here? I don't think so. You know, as 10 or so fifth graders are like crawling around and standing up and sitting down, you know, just what they normally do, restlessly, enthusiastically, ready to act out the Bible stories, because they got to act out the Bible stories. And Jeff's hook, like to get them all seated, was that everyone would get a chance to play God. So that was good. There's also no pictures of OWL, which back when Jeffrey was here, OWL, Our Whole Lives, the curriculum was only in the eighth grade, and it was, you know, human sexuality, soup to nuts. And they had a preview for parents, and I was like, wow, you know, this is a little different than my Catholic upbringing. They, you know, they complained every Sunday, as, you know, adolescents will, but you know what, they never missed a Sunday. They didn't want to go, but then of course they went. And I'm so grateful that he had that really healthy human sexuality foundation. So I do want to express my deep gratitude to all of you, because you've all watched him grow up in this congregation, and to the other parents who taught alongside me in the religious education classes, and to the leaders of this congregation who provided a supportive and engaging community for Gio and his young friends to explore and learn and grow. And I think we've done a pretty good job, quite frankly, and we are so blessed to have these amazing new young adults among us. So that's kind of that was one part of what I was supposed to do in terms of my experience growing a kid up here, in here. The other part is the parents are going to celebrate their children. At this moment. So it's just a brief, I'm going to celebrate both Jeffrey and Frances because her moms couldn't attend. So, Gio, I am honored and to affirm and celebrate you today. It's been a joy. It's been a joy to witness your growth and development over the years. Your outgoing nature, your positive can-do attitude, and goal setting continue to impress me. You've made so many close and lasting friendships and relationships in school with your peers and teachers and coaches, in swimming and Nordic skiing, in Boy Scouts, in the neighborhood, with extended family members, and of course here at UU. I'm so proud of the young adult you are becoming. I trust that you will continue on your path in a focused and joyful manner, making additional friends and exploring and learning new and exciting things along the way. Your attention to a healthy lifestyle and a work mindset, gratitude, and having fun will take you far. And putting aside our disputes over screen time, laundry, dirty dishes, and empty seltzer cans, you are truly a pleasure to be around. You make me smile and remind me and to embrace life with love and laughter. I'm so blessed and grateful to have you in my life. Okay, Francis. So Francis is and her twin sister too, what couldn't be here, but and I'm a twin, so I'm special warm place in my heart for Francis. So I'm so honored to affirm and celebrate you, our friend Francis, as I stand in for your moms who couldn't attend. Francis, you are always a joy to encounter. Quick with a warm smile, a kind word, and always very interesting plans. Your love of your family, the outdoors, making music, and acting are fundamental to who you are and who you are becoming. Your wide social circle speaks to the empathy and love you show for others. You have a wonderful demeanor and presence. This may be partly due to the actor training in you, but I also believe it's a big part of your intrinsic nature. I'm excited for your new friends, your increased freedom, and unique opportunities that await you at UVM next year. Best of luck as you continue your journey to adulthood. We will all be watching eagerly to see where life takes you. And I have no doubt it will be a beautiful and fulfilling ride. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kristen Caney, and I am the mother of Jackson Caney. And when David emailed us parents to say that we needed to be heartfelt, I'm like, heartfelt? That's my middle name. And it's Jackson's worst nightmare. For his mother to be given permission to gush publicly and heartfeltfully, is that even a word? But Jackson, we are also told it can only be 1 to 2 minutes, and you know that I am a rule follower, so bear with the pain. You make a mama's heart so happy. Jackson, I admire you for your kindness, your intelligence, your curiosity, your reverence for Mother Earth and animals, your tolerance of all people, except for me. Your athleticism, your musicality, your uniqueness. I love your uniqueness, and it is such a joy watching you grow into the person that you are going to become. It's been so fun to watch you discover science and medicine, and now you're going into nursing to help make the world an even better place. And I can't believe it, but you're becoming an even more graceful and athletic skier. And now you've found a new passion in the sport of rugby, which was my sport, and it just brings me so much joy. Whatever your path, Jackson, I know that it will be wonderful and you will be successful. I admire you, the courage that you've had to exhibit, the kindness that you show. When you were 3 years old, your little friend, her little brother, who was 1.5 or 2, he dropped his ice cream cone. Jackson, at age 3, gave the little boy his ice cream cone. What 3-year-old does that? My Jackson does. That is your essence. And I'm very confident and comfortable that the world is in good hands with you and with all of the other graduating seniors and all the kids here. I'm very confident and very proud of you, and I love you, and the 2 minutes is up.
I'm Rustem Zia, and this is a poem I wrote a few months ago. I know I am a fool to think I can fly alone. Still, my bones are light, my feathers strong. What have I to atone? I know I have the wind to lift me, and the earth, the sea, the stars. Would they not also gift me the worth, the we, the fars? I do not seek it out, just as not sit, dive into mire. If only I could want the same which I desire.
My name is Caitlin Waddick. My son's mother held a vision for a magical child to become aware of the love and magic that surrounds him now and always. She wanted him to build strong, healthy boundaries to develop awareness of self and others. She created brave spaces for him to play and for fantasy. She wanted for him to be open to the beauty and softness of the world, and he is. Rustem Zia is one of the youth in today's bridging ceremony. Nearly 18 years ago, I birthed him at home in Boulder, Colorado, just before sunrise. Nursing him for the first time, I watched the sunrise through the back doors of my living room, the bright light glistening off the glacier at Rachel at Rocky Mountain National Park. Rustem learned how to walk and talk in San Jose, California, and by age 3, he was riding a bike in Vermont. Rustem is American, Pakistani, biracial, May, Gale, gay, and tall. He is a tennis player, a programmer, a cook, a devil stick juggler, and an actor. He is a brother to 2 older sisters, one of them's here today, Nika, and a son to me and my husband, Asim. Rustem is creative in the kitchen, the pottery studio, and on stage. He enjoys hiking, reading, studying languages. He and his friends play Dungeons and Dragons. And in a program called Way of the Bard, he explored drama and performance, magic and spirituality, nature and hiking. As a family, we cook together and go hiking and travel, and we've joined marches for various justice causes. We rode the bus with other UUs to Washington, D.C. and New York City for the climate justice marches in 2014 and 2017, and we've marched in Burlington and elsewhere. Rustem is a fourth-generation Unitarian Universalist, and he has a Sufi heritage going back much, much farther. My son's mother is proud of him for who he is and who he is becoming. They both love reading and they exchange book recommendations. They both love plants and gardening and worshiping their cat. My son's mother has protected him from owl bears and dragon turtles, and she wants that he will always find the courage to explore new facets of himself and to trust in the process of life. Rustem, may you always be smart and kind and funny, and may you always know love and faith and wild and resilient hope.
Good morning. My name is Susanna Hopkins, and I'm Sophie's mom. We feel so grateful for Sophie and the many years she has been nurtured in the UU community. She's been coming to this UU since she was an infant, visiting her grandparents during the winter holidays and in summers. Inspired by this UU and also Gary Kowalski, as Susie was, we joined the UU church where we lived in Virginia, and Sophie was fortunate to attend RE from kindergarten through the 8th grade there. After we moved to Vermont, Sophie joined the youth group here, which has been a really important part of her life. Learning how to listen, accept, care for others, engage in social justice, care for the environment, and just plain have fun are things that we as parents are glad that she has found here. Many, many thanks to all the youth leaders, teachers, and congregations who are also wonderful and helped instill the values and love that Sophie carries with her today and into her very bright future. We are very proud of the person you have become. Our wish for you, Sophie, is to go gladly into adulthood and have many adventures, but remember that we are always here for you. We love you.
Years and years ago, when a lot of you might not have been here, but a lot of you were, we were both 11, so it would have been 7 years ago, which for us was a very long time. Should we introduce ourselves? It says it on our name tags. My name is Kira.
I'm Amelia, and we're not kidding this time.
Our name tags would give us away. We're twins, and back when we were 11, we got accepted into the National UU Children's Choir and had an absolute blast. But in order to raise money for the trip, we sang an arrangement of Blue Boat Home, and we've grown so much since then, but I just remember how awesome you guys all were. Like, you were super sweet to us, and it was really nice, and we wanted to sing it again for you, not just because it's fun, but because,
well, we were amazed with how much you all pitched in to help after we did that.
Do you want to start?
Oh, I don't know. I guess.
Though below me I feel no motion, standing on these mountains and plains, far away from the rolling ocean, still my dry land heart can say, drifting here with my ship's companions, all we kindred pilgrim souls, making our way by the lights of the heavens in our beautiful blue boat home. I give thanks to the sky, my sail.
Good morning. David told us we had to follow that. I'm like, thanks a lot. So, it's so hard to believe that we're standing up here celebrating Karen Amelia's transition to the next stage of their lives. The first time they came to this congregation, they were teeny tiny preemie babies. They were only 6 weeks old. They have literally grown up in this community. From the first stewardship celebration event as babies who were passed from person to person in the parlors, to their first ever camping trip, which was at Lake Elmore. Martha Dallas and the youth group helped us to put up the tent while Kira and Amelia ran in opposite directions away from the campsite. They've done religious education and children's choir, the Boston trip, an OWL and youth group. I have stood in front of this congregation to speak so many times and give thanks for so many things. But today I really want to thank all of us, all of you in the community, for being such a safe, supportive, and welcoming space for our family for so many years.
Kira, we are so proud of you. You have such a commitment to social justice and are willing to stand up and loudly speak about what you think is right. You are honest and brave and kind, and we know that wherever you go in the world, you will bring your energy and your humor and your enthusiasm. We love you very much.
Amelia, we are so proud of you. You are thoughtful and kind, and always looking for the best in everyone around you. You make sure everyone feels welcome and included. We know that wherever you go in the world, you will bring your sweetness, your humor, and your love of nature and the world around you. We love you very much.
We hope that both of you are able to maintain the connections you've made and are open to new possibilities. We hope you find joy and community wherever life takes you, next year and in the future.
Oh, so full. So before we invite you up here to ritually embody this transition, I just want to share a brief reflection. As I mentioned to you, I had the honor to be invited to be one of the contributors to this really beautiful book called Becoming, which is essays from young adults about the journey of young adulthood as a spiritual resource for you all and other young adults as you go into the unknown of life. And that's really what, so I just wanted to share the one that I contributed because it helps bring me back to that message I spoke of before, that we do this together. Because as cheery and joyful as we get in these moments, underneath it, I'm guessing there are probably also some pretty present anxieties too. Like, whoa, this is a big change. What am I going to do with my life? What's going to happen next? And I just wanted to share about how I navigated that a little bit with you all. So this piece is called Embrace. So what do you want to do with your life? There was a time when this question haunted me like a semi-permanent existential crisis. Some might call it being in your 20s. But it didn't feel to me like this pain of not knowing was just to be expected. I remember poring over inspirational books, searching for answers. I got some good nuggets for the journey, like Mary Oliver proclaiming, "You do not, contrary to popular belief, have to be good." Or Rainer Maria Rilke, somewhat annoyingly, yet undoubtedly giving the wise counsel to love the questions themselves. At least I learned I had some company in the struggling. Though I didn't know where I was going, I found the courage to get on the move anyway, zigging and zagging to be sure, but following my heart, and soon I was New York City bound, pursuing my dream of legal temping. Sorry, that is my dream of acting. Legal temping was a side effect. But even as I began finding real work in the theater, I still wasn't sure. Was this it? Was this my purpose? I remember so well watching the musical Avenue Q, as Princeton, the protagonist puppet, opened the drama with the question of all questions, what do you do with a BA in English? Everyone else has a purpose, so what's mine? Gotta find out, don't wanna wait. Gotta make sure that my life will be great. Gotta find me. Fast forward. Some of you have heard this story before. I was on the 50th anniversary European tour of West Side Story, and I was Tony. It was the pinnacle of my career in a role that felt made for me. But as we were playing Vienna with Paris around the corner, I was dogged by a sinus infection and struggling with the famous high notes of Maria. I feared the consequences, and they came. A new Tony for Paris, and a ticket back home for me. I was devastated. I'd overcome so much, followed my passion, pounded the pavement, and reached this stage of my dreams. I could feel the glow of my parents' pride watching me perform at Le Châtelet, but it wouldn't be. Instead, a dear friend who traveled to see me held my hand as I took in the news. Castmates' tears transformed my own. Autumn leaves enveloped me in a golden glow of breathtaking beauty. And my parents shared their pride at my courage facing this loss. Meanwhile, I penned the word, the wonder ministry, in my journal for the first time. In other words, I experienced love anyway. I used to think that finding my purpose meant finding a tiny intersection point between my passion and the world's great need. Then I began to take faith that the world needed passionate people. People who have come alive, as Howard Thurman put it, and that belief still guides me. But maybe the greatest learning has come from feeling my quest to find me transformed through the experience of finding we. Experiencing myself as one who is loved and who has love to share, this has been to come alive. So what do I want to do with my life? Embrace it. Can I get you guys to come on up here with me? So I hope it's obvious from the essay and from everything I've been saying, but I want to say it just one more time. Whatever comes ahead, there are going to be a lot of transitions. The thing that I want you all to take away most from this morning is that you belong. You belong. You belong here, and you belong to yourselves, to your families, and wherever you're going. And that never changes. So we're going to help them remember that. I think we're going to get the kids to come up because we want you to have a front row seat for this, and also you can be a part of helping them really get this message. So I'll pass over to Reverend Tricia while kids, you come up and let's gather stage over here on the house
right side. We've actually reserved a little bit of space for children on this front pew if you want, or on the floor right in front like we did last week. So you are not just passive observers, neither are the rest of you. We're actually going to greet the youth as they go up and go down the stairs. And you have an important role, children, in helping to celebrate that. I would also like to say that if there are young adults here, and I'm not gonna give you the age, anyone who is feeling like a young adult or who would just like to get up and be over here someplace, you know, Jen, maybe we can scooch in front. And so some adults could be behind you. I'm inviting adults to also, young adults to also meet them, but I don't want them to step on children when they do that. So that's why I'm thinking we could scooch in a little bit tighter. Oh, wonderful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So over
here. Come on down.
Go up the side, Kate, go on up the side aisle, and we'll greet them.
Yeah, and we could even have a couple of older adults, too.
No, really?
Yeah, let's widen this family picture here.
Yeah. Any,
we've already got a crew over there. Yeah, that's right.
It's good. Oh, my goodness.
Mark and Susie and Brian and Peter are over that side.
Yeah.
But if anybody else wants to just come down and strengthen. But Valerie's coming down. Nice.
Good. Okay. And don't worry. You can help celebrate, too, even if you're right where you are. So hang on, because we need the streamers, but not quite yet. I actually have two questions for you, congregation, for you, because we have a part to play in this too. So I want to ask you, do you offer these young persons your good wishes, your love, and your blessings as they enter into this new chapter of their lives? Second question, will you always welcome them in this place, this congregation, the congregation you all share and care for and hold in trust for the generations that follow? Will you welcome them whenever they are here? All right, I'm just going to give you one more instruction here. After the bridging actually happens and we greet and celebrate and streamers and things like that, that's when everybody in the congregation is welcome to greet one another. Remember, greeting each other, however you want to do it, greet the bridgers, greet each other. We'll have a little extra time to greet one another.
Okay, we're ready to bridge.
We are.
So Jen, if I could ask Jen as one of our wonderful youth advisors.
With appendage.
There's no danger in handling fire with your child around your neck. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna do, we're gonna invite each of these youth to come across and light a candle to honor this moment and themselves in this transition. But we have some youth that aren't here with us participating in the ceremony. And so I just want to name those. And we'll light a candle for each of them. Anders Telemark, Xander Herrick, Lara Zoe Hackett, Alex Frank, and Tiana Rondal. That's perfect. We have a couple more that aren't. Actually, let's do Azora Hart right now, too. Francis, I'm going to invite you to light one for Elliot when you go up. Not right now, when you go up. So, and we have a moment to honor Azora in the midst of the ritual, even though she won't cross and Elliot won't cross, so that you're good now. Why don't you set it down, blow it out and set it down, and then come on back down here. We're figuring it out together. Perfect, thank you. So when we call your name and say a few words about you, and I wish we could tell you that we are gonna call you in the order that you are arranged, but that's not how it's actually gonna happen. see if you can figure this out. We're gonna call you in alphabetical order of your first name, because that's how the slides got arranged. Amelia, you're in the right place. Well, otherwise you can figure it out by this point in your lives. So invite you to light a candle, then come over here. And then Jen, do you wanna be the gift giver? We have some beautiful chalices to give you all, and also this book that I mentioned called Becoming. So we invite you to come over and receive that. I think we're ready to begin. So, Amelia, you're first. Amelia is graduating from Essex High School and taking a gap year, so next steps will probably be finding a job and preparing for college, maybe spending some more time doing volunteer work here at the UU, and then after that, hoping to go to college at UVM. She remembers sitting on the lakeshore at Rock Point with the youth, singing in harmony together, watching the sunset, grateful for so many moments of laughter together in this group. Laughing together is what she thinks of most when she thinks of youth group. And she also feels grateful for having such a friendly and understanding group to share and spend time with. She hopes that she can still see people again around the UU and to continue her work here. Doesn't know what her future is going to hold for her yet, but knows that this place and this community is something that she hopes to be a part of for her future. So come on down, Amelia.
Although Elliot isn't here, we wanted to share that she is graduating from CVU, and she's headed to Simmons to study design and production tech, and she's grateful for her family and excited to go to concerts in Boston. So thank you, Frances, for lighting her candle. We're thinking of her. And then Frances is graduating from Burlington High School and headed to UVM to study psychology, and super grateful for her family, growth, and new experiences. Next up is Gio. Gio is graduating from Champlain Valley Union High School as well, and describes his next steps as attending St. Lawrence University to study business and compete on their Nordic ski team. And he finally remembers ringing the church bells in some of the churches they visited in Boston on their trips. And he's grateful for the friends he's made at UU and finishing high school. And looking forward to working this summer at Spot on the Dock. You can look for him there. And then headed to college.
Okay, I think we have Azora here, yes. So Azora is graduating from CVU High School and heading to Dalhousie, is that how you say that, University, to focus on costume design. Azora is one of the youth who is active in earlier stages and in the beginnings of the youth group, but then her passion for theater and for ice skating, which she's actually at an ice skating rink this morning, competition this morning, which is why she isn't with here, carried her away. But we're so excited to be able to honor her, and because she's remembering that this is a place that she can, this place maybe, but in different forms all across the country, always come back to, even if she hasn't been coming as regularly recently. And that's what we hope all of our youth can remember, that this community is here for them. So that's Azora. And we already lit a candle.
Next up is Jackson, graduating from CVU High School and going to Keene State College in New Hampshire, as Kristen mentioned, for nursing. And he finally remembers the UU camping trips at Lake Elmore State Park every June, which marked the end of school for the year and an entrance to a fun summer.
Okay, Kira Lawson coming up, also graduating from Essex High School this year, taking a gap year after graduation to figure myself out, get a job, and after that, hoping to go to UVM. She was born in this congregation, has innumerable happy memories, but a favorite moments always seem to be when we make something new, including arranging music, organizing events, creating pieces of art. She remembers putting together bags of dry soup with other kids to feed the hungry. She loved making Oakland the octopus, creating harmonies on the fly in front of the beautiful sunsets at Crow's Path. She hopes our congregations will always be full of creation and that she will always be part of that. She's so grateful for all the time spent in youth group and for all the friends made in this congregation. And she really wants to find more places to share her voice. Hopefully becoming a young adult has opened up some more possibilities for her to do that. She wants to get to know the congregation even better now. So that's one of the things she plans to be doing during her gap year. Come and get your gift, Kira. I gotta find your page, Rustam. If it's not here, I can go digital. Okay, I'm gonna go digital. Okay. Ready? Rustam, come on up. Graduating from Champlain Valley High School and heading to University of Vermont for computer science. Rustam is grateful for all the support from his family and the various communities that they've become a part of. Thank you, Rusty. Okay, last but certainly not least, Sophie. Sophie is graduating also from Essex High School, planning to apply for AmeriCorps for a year before coming back here and going to UVM. Sophie's so grateful for everyone in this community and for religion, for having given her a chance to come belong to a community and let her express and enjoy a belonging that is really cherishing. She's looking forward to enjoying this place for years to come, especially when she comes back from college for Christmas. All right.
So, it is time for children to get ready to go off to class. Before you do that, we're all going to applaud and be happy, and you definitely should wave the streamers, okay? And while that's happening, I hope that all of you will just merge into the congregation and meet at least two people you don't know, okay? Meet two people you don't know already. That's your assignment. Go.
just kidding. Looks like the choir wants to sing us a song. Let's make that possible. Come on back now, you hear? So, believe it or not, the service isn't over. We have more on this festival service day. Get comfortable, we're gonna hear from our choir.
That song, Sure on This Shining Night by Samuel Barber, I remember it well from the first time I sang it 50 years ago while I was in college. Ouch, that's shocking, but I think I did the arithmetic right. Thinking back to my first days in college, what I mostly remember is faking it. I didn't know how to do things. I was trying to find my place in what seemed like a very large, complicated place where everybody else knew why they were there and how they belonged. I mean, I had chosen the school and they had decided to let me in and I was lucky to be there. I knew that and it was going to be great. Yeah, sure. I was desperate for friends, but also desperate not to look needy, you know, that difficult mixture. I certainly wasn't going to tell anybody how I felt, what I was scared of, how uncertain I was about everything, how hard it was to fall asleep in a strange bed in a strange room, also occupied by a stranger whose name was Peggy,
who was somehow my roommate. I signed up to audition for the chorus. Peggy knew how to do that. I also got a campus job following Peggy, who knew where to go to apply. Roommates can be really important. All 4 years I was in college, I sang in the chorus. You know, we didn't spend that much time together. We had one rehearsal a week. We had 4, maybe 5 concerts a year. But the people in the chorus are the only friends from college that I am still in touch with. The pandemic gave us, some of us, a need and an opportunity to reconnect, first on Zoom and occasionally in person. Something about singing in a group. You actually get to know one another pretty well in some ways. And I've also noticed singing in choruses that you don't actually know everybody's name. And it doesn't matter. You know what I mean? You know the person you're standing singing next to. You know that tenor who does such an amazing job on solos. You know that funny, sweet bass maybe, and a few altos who have an impressive grasp of their notes and frequently disdain for the sopranos who whine when we don't get to sing the melody. We sang Sure on This Shining Night in my sophomore year, I think. It is a hard piece. It was easy to be annoyed by the choices the composer had made. We learned it, and singing it together was life-transforming in a way I can't really explain. It was such a beautiful thing that we did, not because we knew all the notes or got it exactly right, but because together we made this beautiful, amazing sound. And for those few minutes, we got to be in the middle of it. We were making it together. I can't quite remember it, and I'll never forget. I was thinking about what I should call this little homily, and I thought the only thing that makes sense is to say, we are all crossing the bridge. Perhaps you too. Perhaps you have left home to go to school or to travel or to take a job or to move in with a partner or to live by yourself. Whether or not you were able or willing or non-frantic enough to notice those moments, you've had them or you're about to. We are all growing up, no matter how old we get, which is amazing and terrifying. In my neighborhood, there's a newborn next door to us. I think he just turned 2 weeks old. He's utterly dependent on his wonderful, loving parents and his 5-year-old brother, and he's already beginning to show up as himself. There's a woman who lives down the street who's recently become a widow. She just had a big yard sale because she's selling the house that she and her husband lived in for so many decades together. Another neighbor has a dog who's just a little older than Waldo, who will, just to let you know, celebrate his 13th birthday this week. This little doggie has dementia now. He's 15, he has joint problems, he has trouble sleeping. They're all adjusting in that house. And I'm adjusting. I'm retiring in a few more weeks after 27 years of ministry and 20 years before that of working in other jobs and raising children. I am not here to tell you that this is the way life is and is meant to be, that life is change, and it's always marked by new opportunities and surprises and loss and grief, even though that's all true. I am thinking about the ways we find ourselves in the different chapters of our lives. We really don't do it on our own, even though we think, as David says, our quest to find me is transformed by the experience of finding we, wherever that we is. Even if we aren't aware of how much difference it makes to be in a community, even when we can't quite remember. I joined the chorus in college because I wanted to sing with other people. Because of what we did and were together, it's a precious memory to me. Because of our relationship with one another and our connection to our choir director, whom we loved and respected and made fun of, and then after he left, which was terrible, our relationship with a new choir director who was very different and also loved. I've been lucky in my life, and maybe you have too. And maybe you can will continue to be lucky. I want to end with just a little prayer written by a colleague, Maureen Kaloran, a prayer for you. As you step forward into your next chapter, we send with you our fondest hopes and blessings. May life bring you enough challenge to fuel your dreams, enough affirmation to honor your gifts, and enough nurture to give your spirit peace. Believe in your vision, follow your dreams, and know always that when you return to this home, you will find the love and the welcome of friends. So may it be. Can somebody help me move a little furniture? You probably know this already, but the offerings this month are being shared with DRUM, the group that is, the full name is Diverse Revolutionary Unitarian Universalist Multicultural Ministries, which provides support to UUs of color in the form of gatherings and pastoral care. It's critical, this DRUM is, to sustaining UUs of color in congregations like ours and in our denomination, to do the work of becoming more radically welcoming. Your contributions support our congregation's sponsorship of DRUM. Betsy's going to come up and do a short meditation, and after that, you will be welcome to come up and put a stone of joy or sorrow or happiness or whatever you like over here, and perhaps your contribution to the offering on this side, or both, or neither. All are good ways to share.
I don't want to counteract my husband, but I'm thinking that the budget meeting may be a tad bit delayed so you can get coffee or tea and then join them in the parlors behind me. Now is the time in our service to embrace quiet personal reflection. I'll start with joys and sorrows. And Chip Patillo emailed this: sorrow for my mother-in-law Elizabeth's death on May 2nd. Also for my wife Claire as she deals with the details of her mom's passing. Elizabeth lived a long and musical filled life. And joy for the youth today who have bridged within this community. They have shown the discipline to bridge between goals and achievement, and we welcome them wholeheartedly. You are welcome to submit any joys and sorrows online, and they will be read the following Sunday. Now let us take a moment to deepen our time together of meditation, breathing in the precious breath of life and breathing out the needed breath of peace. As we enter into a brief period of silence, let us hold that which has been spoken and that which remains unspoken in our hearts. And following the breathing will be a period of silence where you're welcome to get up and place a stone on the table or in the offering. So will you breathe in the breath of life, out the breath of peace?
Thank you.
Let us speak together the words of the to dedicate our offering, all of our offerings, to one another. In service of our mission to inspire spiritual growth, care for each other and our community, seek truth, and act for justice.
Invite you to sing with me this closing hymn together. It's in your teal hymnal, number 1053, 1053. How could anyone? Invite you to stand in body or spirit as we sing together.
How could anyone ever tell you you are anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you are less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. How could anyone ever tell you you are anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you are less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul.
One more time, a cappella.
How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my
Thank you. Please be seated.
We are about to extinguish the chalice and have the benediction and end the service and get that cup of coffee you've been thinking about. But I have one short announcement, not a surprise, but it needs to be said out loud. And that is that the extraordinary gift of having David Ruffin be part of the ministry of this congregation, formerly Youth and Creative Arts Ministry, is coming to an end. Because David is choosing himself, he's choosing the work that calls to his heart and that needs more of his time than this job allows. I am deeply grateful to you, David, for the gift of collaborating with you. It is so cool to have a collaborator who you can trust entirely without actually having a very good idea of what he's gonna do. I mean that. It's a great gift. Isn't it? David will not be completely gone. I know that this congregation will pull him back in for various special, wonderful things. The other announcement may be a surprise to you, which is that we have invited and she has accepted a new position to fill the work of youth ministry and also support emerging adult ministries. Rowan Van Ness is coming back. Some of you don't know Rowan. She was a ministerial intern here a year ago. She has been working in Montpelier as well as being a parent and finishing her fellowshipping, and we talked her into it. Actually, she's delighted and glad to be returning to this congregation. For 2 years, she will pursue her ministry, her solo ministry career at pretty soon, but for a couple of years, she'll be here, and we're glad. And she knows that I'm announcing this today, so. All right, let us extinguish the chalice.
We extinguish the flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and share with the world until we are together again.
Reverend Tricia wondered if I might lend my voice to this wonderful melody with adapted words from Jim Scott from a folk tune as a benediction blessing for our youth and for us all. May your life be as a song. So I will do that. May your life be as a song, resounding with the dawn, to sing awake the light and softly serenade the stars, ever dancing circles in the night. Go in peace.